Now, this is complicated when there's family involved, because it goes back even further, and, you know, it's a little bit different in every situation. But are there any special approaches that you take when it's a member of your family, somebody that you've known for a long time, and you have to be particularly careful, perhaps, in order not to, you know, step on any toes or any long-standing, you know, family feuds or anything like that?
Yeah, it is something that I learned over time. And, you know, it's something that you just have to learn to do. Let me just give you my demographic. My little sister is, I think I would call her a Catholic. Mm-hmm. My older sister is an evangelical Christian and MAGA. My mother is a Mormon. That tells disparity, you know. So when, and my father, before he died, was like me, pretty much a humanist. Okay. Yeah. So when we have Christmas, it's kind of interesting, right? Because the thing about it is we could sit down there and argue about why the Mormons think this and why Catholicism, AME is the church my younger sister's in, and why the, you know, why the evangelicals think this way. Well, the truth of the matter is we sit down there and we don't discuss that religion necessarily around dinner in a group. But individually, I tell you how I've done it with an older sister that was into the MAGA world, if you will.
Yeah.
I looked at her and I made sure to let it be known that I will never allow a politician to get involved in between the relationship that we have, whether we agree or disagree and stuff. And I put that out from day one. In other words, a politician who doesn't give a darn about neither you or me will I allow to go ahead and mess up our relationship. So we can argue, we can talk and all this kind of stuff, but you are my forever sister. I love you. It's not going to change. Now, there are certain things, however, that are material or have material effects. And we went through that with the pandemic. The Trumpist people were completely against the vaccine, et cetera, et cetera. I had a choice to make then. What do I do about the parts of my family that would say I'm not going to take the vaccine, or knowing that they're completely misled? I looked at my sister straight up, well, actually by phone, and I said, look, I don't care what you believe right now, but if you love your brother, I'm asking you a favor.
Yeah.
I'm asking you a favor. Please do this. If not for you, do it for me.
Yeah.
And that was the method that we use as far as her. And I think she did, because I get the vaccine that her people were pretty much fighting against.
Yeah.
You know, so. Yeah.
I felt the same way when early in the pandemic, my mom, she eventually got the vaccine, but she was reluctant to do it at first. And until she did, I did not feel, you know, comfortable driving and taking my kids to for a visit. I couldn't do that. And so it was kind of, my dad was more open to it. He got it first. And so it kind of worked out, but it required engagement, and you can't just say, really, I don't know, to anyone at a certain point, but especially to your parents or your relatives or your loved ones, if you don't do this, I'm just like, there's no chance I'm ever gonna like see you again. You have to interact, and you have to negotiate, and you have to like persist, and you have to engage.
Right.
And it's not an easy, straightforward process all of the time. But the main thing is that you keep the door open. The main thing is that you keep talking. And that seems to be your overriding point, whether you're talking about friends or family or neighbors, engage.
Absolutely. And like I said, and I have told this to friends as well, if I've known somebody for 20 years and this person have gone complete MAGA, and I would be like, you know, I remember telling a person once, I said, brother, I know that you're not a racist, but remember what if it weren't me, it were somebody else or other folks, that is what they would think of you for embracing this guy when you know what he stands for. And then you call yourself, so I look. Yeah. I accept you. I continue to accept you as my friend. I'm not going to let a politician get involved with us. But realize that when you get out of this fog, I must remind you of what can happen. And by the way, you will owe me a forgiveness sometime when I screw up.
Yeah.
And somehow that
yeah, no, absolutely. We have to have right. that amount of grace with each other to forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. We've got to have some margin for error because we're not perfect. You know, I mean, like, you know, wherever we fall down on the political spectrum, you know, we have to, like, yeah, we do stupid things. And, yeah, we overreact. And we all do that. And we have to, like, at a certain point, realize we got to take a step back. We got to breathe and say, okay, let me correct that. Let me, like, you know, let me understand that, like, everybody else is basically kind of in that same place. And so let me like if they do something which is patently offensive to me, you know, I don't have to, you know, lay down the law and shut them out forever. It's possible to heal that, and it's possible to repair that, and it's possible to have a certain amount of flexibility with folks. And I think that's so important. And in an era where a lot of the times we're just shouting into the void. It's you know, ranting and raving because that's what gets the most views and the most hits and so forth. It's difficult to remember that sometimes. You know, it's interesting to me, and I bring it up with you in particular because you do radio in addition to talking. And it seems to me like there's a dimension to that. I know that online stuff and videos and podcasts can be interactive too, but I grew up listening to talk radio where the key thing was people calling in and giving their opinions and having a back and forth between people, you know, predating even the Rush Limbaugh era, where people would call in and interact and give their opinions. And it was not necessarily the case that you just got shut down all the time. It was not necessarily to prove a point. You had to interact and you had to acknowledge and validate somebody else's opinion and hear their actual voice. And I think that's something that often the internet misses. As much as I love it, and I think it's a great way of connecting and communicating, what do you think about the difference, like, in terms of, like, interacting? Because something that you said about your show is that you spend a lot of time listening, and I think that is so important. In a way, like, talk radio, even though it's kind of, like, fading into a medium of the past, had that capacity in a big way. And I guess I'm wondering how we make corrections for, you know, to open that door still in a way that so easily channels us down the rabbit hole of folks shouting at each other. How do we continue to listen? How do we in that digital and mediated way that channels us in all sorts of bad directions?
I do 10 shows a week, 5 at 6 in the morning,
yeah,
where I'm actually on air,
yeah,
and I get regular POTS call, regular plain old telephone
gotcha.
Calls. People call in and
gotcha.
we exchange. At 3 o'clock, I have my internet show, but technology is a great thing. Now I've added on a product that allows people to either call in or come in as well. I don't have the buy-in yet because the people who listen to the show over the internet, they're so used to typing their messages.
Yeah.
So the interaction is still real time.
Yeah,
that I interact with them real time. But sometimes you want to hear a voice, and some of them are learning now, hey, we can actually call into the online show right now,
yeah,
either from our telephones or from some Skype or something else by just hitting the button. That's where I want to get. I want to get to a position where all those typers can continue typing. But at the same time, I want to hear people who want to have a voice immediately to counter my voice come in. And we do have a few of those that happen periodically. But, you know, it is something that what you said is so important. I think for what we need to add to that, the value we add from being real time live is immediately having that back and forth with the people listening in real time. Because, you know, the way attention spans are. It goes away pretty quickly. And if you can capture some of these things in the moment so that the audience in general, because again, like both your audience and mine, I'm pretty sure you get most of your listens and views, etc., with somebody picking you up on a podcast, because that's where I get most of my
Absolutely.
Views. Somebody later on download a podcast and that's how they absorb it. So when you have that live person interacting with you, they add to that. They add to the podcast, because now that person feels it's not just me talking at them, but there's a conversation going on.
You and I need to have a conversation off the air about, like, you know, because I want to incorporate that seriously, like, into the way that I do my show, in addition to all the things you're talking about, your book in my life, because, like, there are ways that people can access the show and call in, but they're kind of mediated and they're not live in the same way that you have set up. So we should talk about that, so that, because I want to get that too, and I want to like pick.
We'll
your,
talk about that.
I want to pick your brains about that. But I'm just so pleased that you have put this together, because I think especially. Well, on the left and the right. I mean, we need to talk to each other more, but I think there is a lot of reaction from folks on the left, and it's completely understandable, because there really are a lot of, like, horrible things and a lot of horrible things that people say. But, you know, still, we have to understand that that often comes from a place of confusion. It comes from a place of pain, and you still have to engage and acknowledge the humanity of the people that you're hearing. And that's that is a fundamental basis to me for everything else. If we don't have that, we don't have a society. And we have to have a society if we're going to, you know, continue living and you know in the way that we have, in the way that will, like, holds us together and keeps us, you know, surviving and comfortable and going for the future. So, Egberto Willies, thank you so much. I really appreciate you being here. Again, the book is It's Worth It, and it is How to Talk to Your Right-Wing Relatives, Friends, and Neighbors. Where can people find out more about the book and more about what you do?
Sure. You can go to politicsdoneright.com/books. To get the book. Again, that is politicsdoneright.com/books. That's where you can find that book and a few others that I have on complementary subjects. And if you want to visit my blogs, you can go to egbertowillies.com, egbertowillies.com. And of course, the site for all our radio shows is politicsdoneright.com. Without the slash books, that gives you the entire site.
Awesome. PoliticsDoneRight.com. Please go there. Please visit. Please listen to the show. Please read the book. And please reach out to someone that you may disagree with in the course of your day, in the course of this week. You might find that you make a friend, and you might find that you make some progress for things in your community. Egberto Willies, thank you again so much for being with us on Facepalm America.
It's been my honor to be with you, sir.
Let's take a quick break, and we'll be back with a message from a listener. This is Facepalm America. I'm Beowulf Rocklin. Facepalm America. I'm Beowulf Rocklin, and we do have a message from a listener. If you would like to send one, or if you would like to speak on the program, you can message or call us at 202-656-6271. One listener emails this, because it has been a while since I'd been on. And they didn't email it. They texted 202-656-6271. Welcome back, Beowulf. I have enjoyed the interview episodes you have done. In the meantime, corporate death penalty, and this is referring to the episode that we did on the corporate death penalty and the possibility that it might be imposed on the Trump Organization. I believe there are thousands of service and product providers that have been ripped off, bullied, or shortchanged by Trump over his lifetime. These people are finally getting their retribution, as the Don puts it. As far as Amazon, Google, and other large monopolies, there are probably millions of small businesses and innovators who have been crushed by these giants and now get their retribution.